correctly with the correct amount.
D20 Radio, your gamer's role. www.d20radio.com.
Welcome to the Save or Die Podcast, a podcast about classical Dungeons and Dragons. If it's in a box, we'll talk about it.
Welcome to the Save or Die Podcast, episode or adventure number 11. We're back for another adventure again this week. As you heard, Lizless again, because Liz will not be joining us this week. And actually, it looks like Mike went with her out of town, because he is nowhere to be found as of today. So he must have went with his
wife. I'm over here!
Was that Kermit the Frog, or...? Anyway, we have two...
Mike to your Liz.
That's right. We have DM Glenn, as usual. Glenn, how are we this week?
Hello, you lucky people. I'm back.
And we have another voice that many people are familiar with, and that would be Julie Hoverson. Julie, how are you?
I'm doing pretty well.
She'll be sitting in as our female perspective this week and giving us the whip around like Liz usually does.
Marmalade!
Wow. And
sorry, that's my Paula Abdul impression.
Yeah. Everybody
that
might be familiar with...
to be the worst... I'm sorry.
Okay, Simon. everybody's heard of Julie's work, 19 Nocturne Boulevard. Julie, is the website 19nocturneboulevard.net or .com?
It's both. They actually connect up together. I just made it easy that way.
Did you? Okay. Can you give us a quick rundown on that series so the new listeners can get an idea on it?
Well, my show it's a drama. It's an award-winning audio drama anthology series. It's basically like Twilight Zone for your ears. We've got over 50 episodes, and everything sort of stands alone. Some of them connect up, but in general, we have stories ranging from high fantasy to sci-fi to horror to dark social commentary to humor and everything in between. For the fantasy buffs, for the fantasy buffs out there, of course, we have two specifically fantasy ones, Sword Kvetch, about an Amazon and her magic sword who have to go rescue a prince from a wizard. None of these are canon to D&D, of course, but they're fun for all the fantasy fans. And and I have one called Dragon, which that kind of, you know, can kind of guess what that's about.
And I'm in there playing drag.
Yeah.
You're in drag?
He plays an old woman in Dragon.
Oh, okay.
An old Jewish woman in drag.
Oh, interesting. And you can go to the 19nocturneboulevard.com or .net, and you can download all those shows and make Julie happy by boosting her ratings to 1 million.
Exactly.
Because the more you download, the more she produces. Well, she produces anyway, but still.
I produce a ludicrous amount anyway.
Yes, and you also are a credited author, too, as far as... you've had something published for D&D at one point. Well, something published in a magazine, I should say.
Well, no, it was Grimtooth Traps.
That's still fine.
Yeah. Well, it's a book. It's not a magazine. It's better.
Oh, excuse me.
She had a gaming zine out there, too, for a while.
Yeah.
I did, and though it was aimed at more modern-day horror and all the weird stuff that fell through the cracks. You know, D&D has always had extensive support. Mm-hmm. And so I figured it was covered, so I tried to cover all the little games that weren't getting covered in between, you know, all the stuff that falls through. And that was pretty fun, actually. I got a lot of free stuff. Awesome. I mean, I got to do a lot of reviews of games I would never have looked at otherwise.
That was the whole point of it, right?
Yeah. Well, good. At least we have some authority on the show here with... miscredited printed person. Yeah. All right, so let's head into our first topic of the week of DM Fiat, and we'll talk about what's in that section.
Nope. Sorry.
What?
Nope, you're wrong. Look it up.
I don't have to look it up. It's common knowledge.
Nope. No, no, no.
Okay, so we're going to talk about this week about treasure and how to separate it from your PCs and different ways of giving out treasure. Treasure, what do you think, Glenn, first when you think of treasure, what do you automatically think of?
Gold.
Gold?
Pieces of gold, copper, silver, in bags, many of them.
Yeah, like a Scrooge McDuck type thing when you're jumping in there and swimming around. Yeah.
It's like Scrooge McDuck's money vault, only there's a big dragon in it for some reason.
Okay. And Julie, what do you think of when you think of treasure first?
Well, gold, of course, does come to mind, but it doesn't help that everything's kind of valuated in relation to gold, no matter what you get. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I like to mix it up a little bit. Gems, items, magic, different kinds of stuff. I mean, I could actually send you an awesome picture, but
sure.
There was one. I'd have to scan it in, but there was one day when my when the TV was broken, my brother and I took all the jewelry from my, because I do costuming. Mm-hmm. Took all the costume jewelry I had and built a treasure, and it looks awesome.
Really?
Yeah, we were really bored.
Way too much free time back then.
So
yeah,
yeah, definitely. But you know, when the TV's broken and you're younger, what else are you gonna do, right?
That's true.
Yeah.
So, treasure. Giving out treasure. Is too much too much? I mean, what's the limit for giving out treasure?
That's a damn good question.
Treasure is one of those things, it seems like, well, most of the times I've played games, you tend to run one way or the other. The GM who is, you know, almost Monty Hall and gives you everything in sight, or the GM who you kill something that's, you know, got a lot of experience points. It's a high-level monster, but at the same time, it's like, okay, you got 42 copper pieces and one small gem that's worth a gold piece, and you're like, what?
Mm.
What is he? What is this monster, like, broke?
Well,
I mean, is there really a commensurate connection between, you know, monsters being tough and whether or not they give a crap about gold?
Yeah.
Maybe it wasn't payday for that monster when you actually fought him, you know?
It's true.
Yeah, he hadn't got his paycheck yet, so he didn't have enough money in his pocket.
Yeah, or maybe he got robbed earlier.
True, he got beaten up and taken away.
You know, versions with rich king dads don't grow on trees, you know?
True.
I always have the problem when I'm running my games giving out gold. I always feel that I give out too much, even though players say sometimes you're not giving out enough. Again, a player is going to always say you're not giving out enough anyway, but
pretty I always much.
Have, because everybody it's knows probably, most of the games you run, and per the rules, it's one XP per gold piece. So, you know, I'm always afraid about if I give out a couple hundred gold and, you know, oh, that's some experience. How can I get it away from the players?
They got something going on. They got a discussion going on at Dragon's Foot about that, where people are arguing that you shouldn't give out experience for treasure.
Really?
And there's a lot of people there that don't.
Wow.
Because, you know, the point of the experience is not, you know, to have the most, oh, look, I got all experience, jingle, jingle, jingle. and there was one person out there, I think you had it on a blog or something, where he said he didn't give them experience until they spent the money.
Yeah, I understand.
That's
what he's
interesting.
Saying. I do it as you don't get the experience for the gold until you put it in a secure area.
Ah.
So
because it might get stolen from you.
Well, yeah, or you might spend it.
True.
Oh, heaven forbid.
Mine is you have to store it in a secure area, and then you get the experience for it. Otherwise, it's considered just like a floating type thing.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So it doesn't count until it's in a CD.
Yeah. Until the government has their hands on it giving you interest that they're not really giving you at all.
That's true.
Right. Now, there's something you could discuss sometime in context of any fantasy world is the banking system.
Yeah. Now, if they could, now if you could just get like kingdom subsidies where they would pay you for not killing the dragon.
Well, speaking of the...
You need to go listen to my episode.
All right. We'll go listen to Julie's episode to understand Glenn's inside
right
joke.
Back. Hey, that was a good one. Yeah.
Wow. That was quick, Glenn.
I just warped space and time so I could do that.
Hello, future people. Yes.
Yeah.
That's okay. Glenn is very warped.
As anybody who's listened to anything with Glenn yesterday, know he's warped.
Yeah.
Well, you know, as far as treasure goes in the groups I've been in, they haven't really been motivated by treasure. Yeah, they get the treasure. I mean, I'm not ungenerous with it, but they're always concerned with what's going on in the plot.
Yeah.
And getting,
play with some interesting players. No, I shouldn't say that. I play with predominantly players who are more interested in the role-playing aspects and the storyline aspects, but I've also played with plenty of people who, you know, are just there for the money. It's all that, you know.
Yeah, oh, kill! Spending.
Yeah, it's all about the whatever your local coinage is called.
Yeah. See, I also, because of that, I prefer plot related riches.
Mm-hmm.
What I mean by that is like, okay, clues. We don't have very much money. Well, we gotta go down the dungeon because one of our members was killed in the last battle, and we need the money to raise him. Or my mother's gonna, or this woman's gonna be sit out in the cold unless we raise like 10,000 gold. And I know a dungeon we can go down and find all that stuff. That's great plot related treasure right there.
As opposed to just, you know, Scrooge McDuck jumping into the money pit kind of stuff. Yeah.
Or just, you know, kick the door open, kill the monster, take the treasure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and
You know what's so funny about that is, it really motivates them to figure out a way to get the treasure out of the dungeon.
Yeah.
If we're dealing with, like, weight. It's like, sometimes, you know, if they're there for the money, we're going, at one point they'll have to go, screw it, something's following me, I got to leave the money. But these are like, no, I need that money. Come on.
Yeah, that's true.
Anyway, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Oh, there's also, I mean, when you say plot-related money, there's also prizes that are things other than cash. I mean, other than anything even translated into cash, whether it's, you know, you have to get to the bottom. You have to get all the way to the bottom of the dungeon to read the notation that might lead you to the next thing, or get the clues that are going to help you save the king's daughter from the curse that she's under, or whatever.
That kind of treasure I would give experience for.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, because getting there is the real challenge in that case.
Right.
And that's half the battle. Yo, Joe.
Yeah. And if any... anybody who's ever seen the AD&D first edition, those tables in the back where the treasure tables,
mm-hmm.
where they do stuff like works of art or objets d'art, vases, stuff that isn't money.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm not just talking about jewels and stuff, but, you know, stuff that you could find this in a dragon's hoard.
Yeah.
Sure. And it's not worth money. I mean, it's not money, but it's worth money, and it's not all that easy to get out.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Some of that stuff. Well, vases are breakable. Paintings are rippable. But the other thing that's actually really interesting.
Are we going to take this marble statue? You know?
That's where everybody saves their pennies to get a bag of holding.
Yeah.
But, so many bags of holding out there. There must be a bag of holding R Us store somewhere.
Yeah.
But no, one thing that I've always been intrigued by in treasure, and which isn't done enough, is perishable treasure. Because we all think of treasure in terms of stuff like gold, jewels, marble statue, things that aren't going to rot away or be damaged when you get in water. I mean, they may sink you when you get in water,
yeah.
But you know, if your treasure is things that's more perishable, like
potions.
Well, even stuff that seems utterly valueless to the average person who doesn't want to have to carry it, like they stole the emperor's shipment of candied fruit.
Oh, yeah. That's yeah.
Or
spices.
Furs. Or furs.
Furs, good.
Furs or clothing in general. I mean, this is another thing that people do take for... this is the girl talking. This is another thing that people take for granted in a lot of gaming worlds. They're like, oh, clothing, I'm going to have whatever I want for clothing, you know. Well, you know, trade goods a lot of the time consisted of bolts of fabric and things like that.
That's a good point.
And they're super hard to carry, and they are damageable.
Yeah.
I mean, they're a pain in the butt if you have to carry around a lot of it.
What one orc raiding party on, like, a merchant caravan could give you real problems as far as that goes.
Mm. Yeah.
You have to also remember, not every society is a gold-based society. Like you said, there could be a trading society or a bartering society with furs and spices.
Oh, yeah. You know, it might even, you know, you might even get to the treasure and it turns out it's, like, wood. You're like, what? Yeah. The treasure is sticks of wood? Well, they're wood carvers. They do these, they value this particular kind of wood a lot. You're like, yeah, but it's wood. I can't sell it.
A perfect
you could have sold it to them.
Yeah.
A perfect example of this is later on when they made up the Dragonlance setting, how they switched everything from gold to steel.
Yeah.
There was so much gold around that they changed their monetary to steel because that was so limited. So that became the big money trade system.
Yeah.
Another thing that has always intrigued me that hasn't always been dealt with much is the idea that, you know, everybody assumes that a gold piece is a gold piece is a gold piece.
Right.
But, you know, if you're looking at working with different cultures, you could have different sizes, shapes, values, quantities of gold. I mean, I know this makes it just that much more difficult, but
no, you're right.
You know, people don't ever think about having to go to an exchange and get someone to actually evaluate your gold pieces, because maybe you picked up some from this country over there that they're not really entirely gold, they're half electrum or something, because their exchequer was ripping people off.
Right. There's also the people who take, like, coins and, like, clip the corners off, and they get enough of those they can mint their own coins,
or just melt it down for the ore,
or just melt it down for the metal.
That's one thing that, you know, if you ever, I don't know if everybody here knows, but yeah, that's why our coins, you know, modern coins tend to have the crenellations around the edge.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah?
Is because in old days people could shave the edges off of round coins and save up the shavings. But once you get those crenellations on there, you can't shave it because people would know, because you wouldn't have the right edging.
Ah, right. Did not know that.
Yeah.
One to grow.
She's a font of information.
Yes.
You betcha. But, I mean, these are things that can add a lot of reality to a game, and that's part of the fun is, you know, because it's... It's just like when Charlie Brown went trick-or-treating and came back with a rock. I mean, you could go get some gold pieces, and it's like, oh, we don't take that coin here. I don't care if it's gold. That's some ugly
good
old
rate
money.
Of exchange, yeah.
Rate of exchange can really, 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 you know, torque you if you get into the wrong town, or you end up with a money changer who just doesn't want to deal with you or is going to rip you off because you don't know.
Yeah. You can get ripped off so many ways.
Now, what about a society? Oh, yeah. The society,
and that's how you separate people from their treasure.
Yeah, a society that's not gold based. I mean, what if they're copper based or silver based?
What that's if they're always... based on a metal that you've never heard of that they have?
Exactly,
like electrum. No, I mean,
yeah, electrum. No, we the other podcast they paid Nick in electrum.
Oh yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So training for gold. A lot of people do that. A lot of people don't do that. When you go up a level, you charge them for gold to go up a level to train.
Mm-hmm.
You guys think that's fair, or you just skip that and just go, okay, you get a level?
I'm not saying it's not fair. It's just something I don't do.
Why don't you do that?
I'm lazy.
That's not a good answer. That's not a good answer.
I'm just assuming that the adventures as they are, as we're playing them, usually take place like a certain amount of time between them, which would give them time to train and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Of course, if I ever ran like a big campaign where they're doing something, I would probably make them, okay, nobody levels up until this thing ends. Like, say they're down in the middle of the dungeon, how the hell are you going to level up?
That's true.
Oh, exactly.
I usually give them the hit points if they're down in the middle of a dungeon. Uh-huh. And then once they get back to town, I would just say they would train and they get the rest of whatever they're able to get. So.
Right.
That makes some sense. One thing, as a slight digression, one way that this is handled in a LARP that I've played, mm-hmm. and I like the way they do this, is you actually have to find another player who can teach you a skill, and they actually have to spend a certain amount of time with you.
Oh, yeah, I've seen that.
And that's been really, really... Well, because it also encourages people to interact. And that's and the rarer the skill, the harder it is to find someone, of course.
Right.
And the alternative, though, if you can't find... If there's nobody in-game who can actually teach you that skill in this particular LARP, what they do is they... You go to the plot cabin and you volunteer as an NPC for a couple of hours. Basically, they just trade you out into different costumes and let you go get killed.
Okay.
And and the idea is that during that time, you usually do that for experience points that you can spend on your character. But in this case, you do it in return for your character having left for that period of time to go find a master.
Hmm.
Who then teaches them the skill. And that's actually worked really well, because you can work on a skill you have and level it up yourself, but you can't learn it from scratch.
Yeah.
And that's really handy. And actually it's always really fun.
Playing an NPC
and going and getting killed a lot.
Oh yeah. You got a strange idea of fun, you know that?
Oh yeah, but there's a certain freedom in not having to make your character survive.
I go play Paranoia, I guess.
Uh-huh. Yeah, that's a good point. Paranoia. Hmm. The machine is wrong. The machine is wrong. Anyway.
Hey, it's Tune good. If you don't like Tune.
We all know how Glenn feels about Tune, though.
Oh, hush.
Well, the other thing about, you know, talking about separating people from their money is, you know, we do... Another thing that everyone takes for granted is... standard costs for things. I mean, once you have an equipment list, everybody assumes it's like shopping at Walmart and it's always going to cost the same amount.
Oh yeah, yeah, true.
And it's really, I mean, if you even going into a town, there's no reason that every innkeeper should be charging you the same amount of money. It's like, I'm the only inn in town, I'm charging 10 times as much and it's a flop. Well, why are you charging that? We're not going to pay this. Well, go find someplace else. There's no place else. Sure. I'm the only one in town.
Aha. Uh-huh.
I've seen a lot of modules and stuff where they say, okay, they charge, you know, times two on the chart or times three or something like that.
Yeah.
Hmm. Yeah, and, you know, day-to-day living actually costs a surprising amount of money. Ask anyone who, you know, when they first move out of mom's house, for crying out loud. And
yeah.
And so many things that we take for granted or just don't think about. And, I mean, you can just give them a set rate. Okay, this is, it's going to cost you 10, you know, it's going to cost you one gold piece a day just for, you know, general living in your own house.
Yeah. Think about the utilities you pay now and all that, you know.
Yeah. I mean, that's taxes. That's, you know, well, I mean, and there's weird taxes. In historical context, there have been some weird taxes throughout history. There was the reason why, in many places, the reason why armoires and wardrobes were so prevalent mm-hmm. is because there used to be a door tax. They would tax you for every door in your house.
And closets were...
Yeah, and that's... closets had doors, but armoires were furniture.
Mm.
I mean, can you see some regular D&D characters, you know, oh, we're going to buy a house so we don't have to pay in costs anymore. Okay, good. You know, next day, tax collector shows up. Hi, I'm here to count your doors. What?
You have 12. Well, that's 1,000 gold. Come on, hand it over.
What if they do that to, like, people who make dungeons, too?
Wow.
That's where you get the cut rate dungeons. No doors.
Yeah, okay, 12 5 levels times 12 doors. That's okay, that's 3,600 gold.
All right. So, what if a DM
Here's my dragon. He's the one who's going to negotiate.
Yeah. Okay, so a DM, you're doing an on the fly adventure and you realize at the end of the adventure you've given out too much money. Too much gold, too much copper, too much silver, and you're like, "Oh crap. What am I going to do?" What's
Bug him on the way home.
Bug him.
Have
on
him
the...
fall in a river.
Fall in a river.
Also,
he said mug them. I think not bug them.
Oh, I was gonna say bug them.
Mug them on the way home. I would start. If you're not doing it, I would start playing around with, like, how much does that weigh? That kind of thing.
Well,
oh, yeah. I mean, we all joke about the overloaded, you know, the overloaded henchman or whatever, the, you know, the donkey. I mean, there's a classic story about two guys who agree to split a gold nugget they find that is ginormous. And they get back this huge gold, and this is in real life. A story. They get back to town and they argue over who carried it the whole way. They're like, no, I carried it most of the way. No, I carried it most of the way. And they take it to adjudication and the judge awards it to the donkey.
I would.
Well, yeah, I've been in so many campaigns when people bring carts and they're like, I'm just throwing things into the cart to bring it back to sell it. It's like, how much can you actually throw in that cart to take back? To actually carry. It's just like, it's got to be some point you got to stop them.
Well, yeah, and the cart can break. Or, you know, and frankly, you know, if you have to run away because something's chasing you, that cart's going to get left behind and you got nothing.
Exactly.
Because the cart is not going to go fast.
Not at all.
It's not like a Ferrari or something. Yep. We're gonna do a cart chase.
Yeah, I mean, if you got, say you got two horses pulling this big cart, I mean, they're only going to go as fast as the horses can pull it.
Yeah.
Exactly. You know, I mean, and frankly, if you have to get away, you're going to cut the traces and ride the horses.
Yeah.
Hell yeah. Not going to get stuck. In
Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay, a human who has really good strength can carry, like, I think up to two times his weight or three times his weight in stuff, which is pretty good. But then if you play a dwarf, you times four that. And it's like, okay, we're all we've all got pack dwarves for henchmen.
Well, now the encumbrance becomes very important if you play with that at all, because
yeah.
I don't know. All it takes is one day when you're trying to move all your junk, you know, and the sci-fi convention into the hotel, and you realize just how little maneuverability you have once you've got armloads and armloads of stuff.
Yeah.
And as a note from my friend Kim, who also LARPs with me, she's also I taught her how to do podcasts, and she has her own show, which is a sci-fi series called Warp Space. Mm-hmm. She pointed out that you learn real fast when you're doing it live, mm-hmm. that that a big bag is not as useful as a number of small bags. Because all it takes is one time when you're running and trying to find something in that big bag at the same time. That you realize that you would rather have color-coded bags so that you know where your stuff is.
Well, just think about going camping. You put that backpack on your back. You got your sleeping bag. You got your rations in there so you can eat. Then you have this bag for that. Just compare it to that. That's what it would be like running around in D&D every day.
Oh, exactly.
So you can't carry everything all the time, especially not a whole bag full of money when you're tired.
Exactly.
Or at half hit points or a quarter hit points or whatever.
You start
at that point you start looking for a place to hide stuff so you can come back later.
Yeah.
And now that would be an interesting scenario. Somebody coming and trying to remember where they hid their treasure and hiring people to help them, and you don't even know if you're going to find it because they're not sure they remember where it was.
Could have been stolen.
You find it and they turn around and they steal it from you.
Well, there's always that.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I think that was an interesting conversation about gold. Any more thoughts about gold and ways to get away from their players from it?
I got nothing.
I've noticed a lot of the time that when people start to get to a really high level, of course, and this is, you know, in real life as well as in game, mm-hmm. people start to convert their gold into something more portable like jewels. And which is good and bad, because sure, you can carry a, you know, 10,000 gold piece diamond or something, and you can lose a 10,000 gold piece diamond.
Just as fast, yeah.
Yeah.
But I mean, but it's also not convertible. I mean, no matter what, you know, you pay that much for it, and it might be worth that. But again, you get rate of exchange, demand, etc. So people should be a little bit more leery about that than they are.
Now, this is the kind of minutiae I wouldn't pull on them unless they had like too much gold or something like that. Just to put it in perspective, that's all.
Oh, I'm sorry. If somebody's going to buy a 10,000 gold piece gem just to keep their money in one place, they deserve it.
Mm,
Yeah, but I'm just saying all this we're talking about.
Oh, well, due to the economy, your gem has gone down to 8,000, and
But you hear that if you go all the way over to this country over there, somebody there is really looking for this kind of gem, this wizard who needs it, and he'll pay double.
And thus, you lose it along the way.
Exchange your town of pawn shops.
Yeah.
Oh, boy, town of pawn shops, yeah.
Well, you know, and that's, you know, haggling and bazaars and things is a whole other category, but you haggle to sell as well as to buy. Yeah. See, that's the thing, is we also forget, you know, that everything should be haggled to buy as well as, or sell as well as to buy. It's like, oh no, this sword's nicked. I can't give you a full.
Oh yeah. Remember, haggling is role playing.
Yeah.
Okay, and cool.
Okay.
So tell us what you think. SaveOrDiePodcast@gmail.com. You can also call us on our voicemail line, 570-290-SAVE or 7283. Again, 570-290-7283. And tell us your thoughts on gold and treasure and what you want to do with it. And we want to hear from your voice. We like hearing voices. Right, Julie?
They love my voice forever and ever.
That's right. So let's move on to random encounters.
Okay.
We take what we want and leave the rest. Just like your salad bar.
Nothing up must leave. Presto!
You will come out no more.
What? Huh? What'll come out no more?
Random encounters.
We have gold dragons this week.
Now, what's the rate of exchange on those?
So gold dragons, as we're talking about this week, ways to use the gold dragon, continue our conversations with dragons as we've been doing for the last couple episodes, except for the last one. So gold dragon, good, bad, or ugly? Which one?
Well, technically, it's lawful.
Yes. It is the most powerful dragon according... I'm looking at the Molve book right here in front of me, the red one. It looks like to be the most powerful dragon out there with the most armor class of -2, and it is the highest hit dice creature they have there, actually, with 11. So, and these dragons pretty much talk all the time. So, these type of dragons, how would you incorporate these type of dragons in your campaign? I mean... Could it be the dragon that's always sleeping that you go to for information? Or is this dragon's the one that's a friend to the king? Or I can't think of ways to use a gold dragon, because I've never actually used the gold dragon itself.
Well, since he's lawful, how about making him, like, the high court arbitrator of your town, the law?
Okay, but why would the gold dragon get involved with people like that? Most of the time, dragons don't want to be involved with people that much.
Good point.
Humans, dwarves, whatever.
I never think about personalities like that. It's like I saw Lawful. I said, yeah, I could see him in a wig with a gavel. You know? But I think that would be a nice little change. Maybe he does want to deal with this town. Maybe the king talked him into it or did something. But it would be a nice little change, role-playing-wise. You understand what I'm trying to say?
Mm-hmm. One of the things I've always thought about, particularly gold dragons, is that they're not really something that you should necessarily ever be fighting. No. I mean, unless you're playing an chaos-based campaign or whatever, the idea is, A, they're super powerful, and B, you know, they're lawful. They're at least, you should be able to negotiate with them at the very least, and at the very most, you should be running away from them.
Yeah.
Should be running away from any dragon in any campaign, but still.
Yeah, but everybody fancies themselves, you know, Conan or something.
Red Sonja, right?
Hey, Red Sonja's my hero. You shut up about Red Sonja.
Don't mess with her, Red Sonja.
I do. Yeah.
Seriously, I have all the old comic books. That was really one of. That's why my hair is red. But anyway,
your hair's red because
you
of Red
don't
Sonja?
Dye it.
Oh yeah, I dye it, but that's why I dye it. Anyway,
they do have a whole set of new series of comics for her out, by the way.
All the new stuff has always sucked. The old ones were actually super creepy.
True,
but No, the idea, though, one of the ways you could use a dragon, and this would actually be very classical, is a lot of, in a lot of mythology, creatures like dragons and things would show up as an omen, or, you know, it was like a punishment for a great badness done by an entire nation or a town or a, you know, something. And right. Something like that, a gold dragon, the lawfulness would come in and it would actually be very functional. If they show up and, you know, their job is to, you know, punish, but they don't necessarily aren't necessarily forthcoming about why or what or anything. And that could be the quest is, you know, you got to go talk to it, find out why it's here.
So it's kind of like, a demon sent by a god or an angel or something.
Well, if you look at Greek mythology, things like the Sphinx, mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know, the original Sphinx, I mean, it was, there were reasons things showed up.
Uh-huh.
Hmm. Well, I like Glenn's idea of the gold dragon actually wanting to adjudicate the society of man because he's bored with just laying around in piles of treasure.
Well, it's not like that, but they would make him like the last court of appeal. I mean, they deal with their own law and stuff, but
the Supreme Court or something?
What?
The Supreme Court he would be or something?
Yeah, more or less. Something that's really heinous or something, they would take it to him. And he would be like, what's that guy who cut the baby in half in the Bible?
Judge Wapner.
Yeah, Judge Wapner.
Solomon.
He's Solomon. He'd be like King Solomon. You know, they'd go to him for the why. Okay, this guy killed that guy and he raped the cat. Help us. What do we do?
Mm-hmm.
Or even more appropriately, in a striated society with, you know, different ranks, you know, nobles could be going, well, you can't really prosecute, I'm a noble. And they're like, higher court.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Send him to the dragon. Tell it to the dragon, buddy.
But you could also go with the downside of extreme lawfulness and have the dragon kind of turn into Big Brother and you can't do anything.
That's another good, yeah.
He's always watching you.
Well, and you know, it's like, literally, you did something wrong. You're going to be punished. You did this, you know. And so you have this society living in, you know, fear of having done the wrong thing constantly. And they might hire adventurers to get rid of their dragon overlord, even though, you know, the trains run on time and all those other classic
cliches. That would
cliches
be a literal draconian society.
Exactly. What's
preventing the dragon from hiring, like, orcs and goblins and stuff to enforce?
If he's working with extreme lawfulness, they would have trouble dealing with that.
All right, other lawful monsters, then, you know.
Yeah.
This is my storm giant Major Domo over here. You know?
I always like changing things up every once in a while. Well, why can't a gold dragon be like a chaotic dragon? Why does he have to be lawful? Maybe he was raised by a black dragon.
That's true.
It's possible, true. But there'd have to be a backstory for it. And it would have to be something, I think, that would be discoverable, or else it's just randomly changing things.
Well, yeah, I mean, if a clever DM like myself can make a wonderful backstory of what happened to this gold dragon. And, you know, I just like to change things up every once in a while so everyone's like, oh, a gold dragon, he's fine. We'll go up to him and just talk to him.
Or he could just be testy. Well, I mean, he just could be in a crappy mood. Or you could have a gold dragon who is, oh, now there's a good one, a gold dragon who has some kind of dragon disease. That means that, you know, maybe he's raving.
Like dragon cancer or something? Or
like dragon
dementia.
Fever. Dragon dementia or dragon fever, where he doesn't actually want to hurt anybody, but when he's in the throes of a fit, he just attacks everything on sight. And then afterwards he's like, oh, oops, sorry, apologies, here, have some gold. is your friend going to die?
Oops, sorry, I just charred your wife. Here's some gold.
Yeah. You know, and maybe the quest then is to find the ingredients for the cure, or find somebody who can cure the dragon.
I've got this image of
as a GM, I would give the players full experience for killing the dragon if they cured the dragon. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That'd be cool. Yeah. That'd be
an equivalent. Oh, yeah.
So that could be the basis of a quest right there.
Exactly.
Thank you. It gave me a great idea for a game.
I know. Julie giving us ideas now.
Yeah.
I am an idea person.
Julie is our muse.
Yes. You know, I have this
I want to be Calliope.
Jeez.
How do you play? How do I play you? Anyway.
No, Calliope is the muse of joyous music.
Circus? Oh, it's joyous music. You know, this gives me a wonderful image.
I know
of,
way too much Greek mythology.
You do.
No, but that'd be a great basis for a campaign, Greek mythology, so that's good to know that.
Yeah. With dragons.
Yeah. Why not?
Okay. Yeah, sure. Okay.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Well, anyway, another thing people, I mean, like I say, people tend to go, oh, gold dragons, they're all friendly or whatever. I mean, they're at least, you know, you could talk to them, blah, 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 blah. But, well, no, I mean, we all read The Dragon Riders of Pern. No.
You did.
I'm a girl. But the thing is that and just because they're lawful doesn't mean they actually even have to be friendly. And people do forget that. I mean, you can have any personality you want because they are intelligent. And anything above animal intelligence has some kind of personality, you'd think.
Yeah. He could be pissed.
Apart from certain... Yeah. No, I won't say that.
He could be pissed that you're going into his cave and want you out.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Get off my lawn!
Damn kids!
You know, there's no reason that he has to want to deal with you at all. And that's the thing, is that people forget that, you know, it's not just numbers on a page. If it's intelligent and it can have a personality and it can just not like you.
If anybody knows anything about the games from, you know, the white box all the way up to 3.5, is they've always said alignments are a guideline.
Mm-hmm.
Not etched in stone. So, okay, it says he's lawful. So he's chaotic lawful. I don't know. You know, it depends on his mood when he wakes up in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's not going to go frying everybody that comes in there, but, I mean, you know, he's not going to be fun before his coffee. So
I'm no good before my first halfling of the day.
Yeah, okay.
Decaf.
Oh, decaf halfling. Ugh.
A decafling.
Decafling, yeah.
This sounds like an event in the Olympics.
No, that's dwarf tossing.
Hmm.
But yeah, there's a lot you could do with a gold dragon, or any dragon for that matter. I mean,
well, at least a gold dragon you have a chance with, because most other dragons will just attack anything on sight, it seems like.
Yeah.
And as such, I mean, there's other colors that show up in Dragon Magazine and later supplements and whatever, but, you know,
yeah.
I don't know, the neon green dragon, the, you know.
The paisley dragon.
The pink dragon, too.
So, yeah, folks, we got lots of ideas. How would you use a gold dragon?
There you go.
I don't know. Give us an email, like Glenn's suggesting, at saveordiepodcast@gmail.com. Or what else can they do?
They could call our number.
Call the number? Or they could. You have forums, don't you?
Yes.
We could
do the Dragon's Foot forums, or we've got a call-in number now.
570-290-SAVE.
Woohoo.
Leave off the last S for mattress. Oh, never mind. I don't know. Let's head into the last segment of the night, the products of your imagination.
Your dungeon master has placed you in a dreadfully precarious position.
Where are the Cheetos?
They're right next to you.
Well, all you do is we play the characters we talked about earlier, and we run around and stuff.
I want to show you a trick Mother showed me when you weren't around.
Use your lightning bolt.
Victory is yours.
I'm attacking the darkness.
Dungeons and Dragons games. Products of your imagination.
You're not there. You're getting drunk.
So, products of your imagination. What do we have this week, Glenn?
Your favorite dragon magazine. Glad you asked me that. I've been waiting for this one.
Okay.
Let's go first.
Me? Okay. My favorite dragon magazine actually is Dragon number 20 from 1978. Why do you say, since this is probably, I was like three then when this magazine came out? Yes, I'm younger than the whole cast. That is correct.
And I'm older.
Yes. It's a Halloween dragon.
And I'm the girl. So I don't have to disclose my age.
That's true. You don't have to disclose your age. You are the girl. And you are like, and the rest on Gilligan Island. You know when they used to say that at the beginning? And the rest. That's like Julie. It's like, what? The professor and Marianne don't even get credit. They're just, and the rest. But anyway. Wow. Anyway, 1978. This is a Halloween-ish type dragon. Actually, it was, I think, came out in October or November. But I love this one because it actually introduces the witch NPC class. It focuses a lot on in this issue of demonology and demonic possessions in D&D. So I love the articles. It's interesting. Pick it up. Read these things. Especially if you like using demon gods in your campaign, use this magazine. It gives you a lot of background information, a lot of sources. Use it. Abuse it. Enjoy it. That's my favorite. That's my favorite. No, really, I love this dragon. It has a great cover. It has like a carriage running away from, I forget what it is offhand. I can't think offhand. It was a carriage running away from something. Uh-huh. Very Sleepy Hollow-ish looking, but. So, Glenn, we're going to leave you. No. Glenn, you're going to be last. Julie.
Oh, no, well, I can't give you numbers because this. I can't got number. I can't give you numbers because this got sprung on me. But I can give you. I can the thing that stuck in my head, and it's probably so. Oh Lord, I can't even guess what numbers it is. There was a dungeon in one of them called Chagmat.
Chagmat.
It was a spider base. There were these spider. There were eight different colored spiders, and they were in a cave system that was vaguely looked like a web. And they were big spider monsters. It was a proprietary monster or whatever. I mean, you know, something specific for this game, I think. And it was just I loved that one. And maybe going back to it, I wouldn't love it as much. But that one I ran a number of times for different groups because I really liked, because it had a theme. And things kind of made sense and held together, which you didn't see in every dungeon back in the old days.
Mm-hmm.
And I really, really liked that. I don't think it was the same issue, but another issue somewhere around there was the one where the Grauf dragons escaped from what's new and were all over the magazine.
Cool.
That was an April Fool issue, I think.
That was, but it lasted for a couple of issues, actually, before they managed to get them all cleared out again.
Well, Foglio, yeah.
Well, cool. Glenn?
Yeah.
Okay.
We ran out of time, so sorry, Glenn. No, okay.
That's all right.
But as a side note, the Folios do audio drama, too.
Yes, they do. Yes, they do.
So, Glenn, what's your favorite issue?
I had a lot of issues that I like for bits and pieces, but my favorite issue, and this is getting into the edition that Vince absolutely hates, second edition, Dragon number 184. The reason being, it had this wonderful section on bad guys.
Okay, go on.
They have several articles, one called Really Good Bad Guys, gave you great tips. Another one called You Again, How to Use a Recurring Bad Guy, and things like this. But this is kind of peripherally with the bad guys, but it was in the same section. It had this article called that is the 7-sentence NPC.
Mm-hmm.
I love this article. Because I've used it not only in gaming, but in my writing. I try to use it in the lumpers. And it's basically how to describe a character in 7 sentences.
Okay, give us an example.
Okay, here's an example. Let me pull this up real quick.
Okay.
Rand the Elder is a blacksmith who wait a minute, let me get my glasses on. Okay, now I can see it. Rand the Elder is a blacksmith who has spent all his life in Arabelle. He is a tall man with a heavy black beard. Rand is known for his strength, 16, skills of blacksmith, and rather dim wit, intelligence 7. He values his family above all, is honest to a fault, and has a great fondness for music. Uncomfortable and a man of few words with strangers, he is talkative and likes to sing with his close friends. With the shop on the main thoroughfare, he hears many of the tales from outside the city, but often gets the facts mixed up due to his slow wit. He talks in a deep, slow drawl and pulls at his beard when talking to others. That 7 sentences right there gives you pretty much an idea of what this guy's all about.
And karaoke.
And it breaks... I didn't see that on here. Wait a minute.
He likes to sing with his friends.
Oh, that's right. That's right. But it breaks it down. It's just like, first sentence, occupation, history. Second sentence, physical description. Third sentence, attributes and skills. Fourth sentence, values and motivations. Fifth sentence, interactions with others. Sixth sentence, useful knowledge. And seventh sentence, distinguishing features.
Hmm. Makes sense.
And it's that like works. That in a nutshell. And it just came useful to me, like, okay, I want to use this one guy. What's he look like? What's he about? And I don't want to write, like, a whole Bible on him.
That's more description than many people have of their PCs.
Yeah, really? Wow.
Well, I was looking at mainly as a DM.
Well, yeah, that's the whole point, yeah.
Yeah, but I, excuse me, I know what you're talking about, but it's been so useful to me over the years that has turned it into my favorite Dragon magazine, even though it has a wonky cover on it.
No, that sounds like that'd be actually a really great tool to use to making up your NPCs or whatever, even a character at that point, too. I mean,
Oh, yeah. I mean, just that one article. I mean, it's like one great article amongst a bunch of really good articles, and that's what I liked about it. It had this whole section I could use.
Hmm.
Very cool.
Don't even get me started on dungeon magazines. But, because I can't pick one. But that's my...
Honestly,
he just starts drooling at that point.
Yes.
As far as dungeon magazines, I never really collected them at all, really. I don't know. I just was never into dungeon magazines. Because, obviously, I thought of dungeon as the same thing as a module.
Right. And
you know what? As Glenn, you already know, I don't really like using modules, so... Dungeon was out, but did you really have a dungeon that you liked that was kind of cool? I mean, you don't have to remember the number, but...
I mean, I can understand you're like Julie, you're an idea person. So.
Yeah.
I did like modules before I started having the confidence to write my own. That's, you know, how far back this goes for me, the one that I cited. Right. I mean, I think I ran Chagmat when I was at summer camp.
There's a couple of scenarios in Dungeon that I absolutely... My favorite one, I told Julie about this the other day, it was called The White Boar of Kilfay.
Mm-hmm.
And it's about this avatar of a god that gets sent down because he wants this one wizard to stop messing around with monsters in his little paddock area. He's been...
See,
like,
now there's something they could send a gold dragon for. I'm sorry.
That's right. modifying monsters. So he sends his avatar down, and it's a Celtic god, and his avatar is sent in his form of the god's totem, which is a white boar. Which is not the greatest thing to send down an avatar with because it can't talk. And basically, he had to go to two villages and kill like two of their people to get them to get on his back so he could lead them to this wizard. And that's how the adventurers get involved in. And once they get into the paddock, it's no easy thing. Anyway, then you got to deal with all these like genetically altered monsters. The biggest thing I remember, the biggest thing was they broke into the wizard's lab and they had to fight whatever his minions were. But the main part of the lab was this giant tank filled with liquid, and basically the monster was there doing like a Luke Skywalker from the second Empire Strikes Back.
Yeah,
and it was a bole. And during the course of the fight, the tank got broke. In our scenario, the tank got broke, and they had to fight the bole. Okay, great bole. About the third turn, they find out what he was doing to the bole, because I turned around and said, "The bole takes a breath and breathes fire." The looks on their faces when I said that were priceless. Absolutely priceless. He breathes fire? oh my God, we're doomed. I loved it. Absolutely wonderful. White Boar of Kilfey. If you can find it, run it. It's great.
Interesting.
Even just the idea is a good one because, you know, the thing is, a lot of times I find I wonder why they include so many creatures of non-chaotic evil or whatever alignments, because you're like, well, you know, it's not like you're going to fight them. They're good guys. Well, it doesn't mean you're going to agree with them either. But if you get something like this avatar where they're there for essentially a good guy reason, and yet they're having to kill random bystanders just to get your attention. That's really right. Sucks.
So
it's a way to put you at odds with something unusual.
Okay, so tell us what your favorite Dragon magazine or Dungeon magazine is. You know the podcast email address. I'm going to encourage more on the phone number, 570-290-7283, and we will play your message on the show and with your thoughts. If you just want to call to say hi, why not? Say hi. If you just want to say hi, Glenn.
Okay, hi, Glenn. Hi, Vince. Hi, Julie.
Yeah.
If you just want to tell us, say hi to me. That's nice.
Yeah. Or you can go on iTunes and you can leave us a 5-star review comment saying how wonderful we are.
Oh, before we wrap up here, I did want to mention one thing.
What's that?
A guy by the name of Jesse Walker, he's on Dragon's Foot.
Yes.
Does a e-zine called Encounter Magazine, all about Basic.
Mm-hmm.
And he did, in the third issue, which just came out, it comes out quarterly, he did a really nice write-up for Save or Die, and I just wanted to thank him for it.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
he did have a nice
plug for us.
Do we have what's the website so we can give him a proper plug?
Let me pull it up here. I just had it.
Is it encountermagazine.com or Encounter?
Encountermagazine.com, yeah. Oh, it's www.encountermagazine.au2.com.
AU2.com?
Yeah.
Australia?
Or you could go to his blog, encountermagazine.blogspot.com.
Okay, cool.
And it's a really good magazine, too, for Basic and just for reading for role-playing.
And it comes out soon, or it's already out?
It just came out. It comes out quarterly. He was a little late with this one, but it comes out quarterly. And it's all full of, like, Basic goodness.
Well, give him an email, Glenn, when you have a chance, or a PM, and give him an invite. We'll invite him on the air on the show to talk about his magazine.
Yeah, and he's on Dragon's Foot. Okay. I can't recall his handle right now, but he is on Dragon's Foot.
Well, I definitely would like to invite him on the show because it's always great to hear from people that help support the community with magazines and audio stuff, anything, because I like to hear his perspective on things on the show. So he's more than welcome to email the show and join us.
Okay.
Well, I think that's going to wrap up the show. Let's take our backpacks, throw it over our shoulder, and play the music that Glenn does not like in the background.
This is the part we have to cry about, Julie.
Yeah. Oh. This is the sad love theme music in the background going dun 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 from the Hulk.
Oh, okay.
I'm trying to get the Bugs Bunny Roadrunner show music.
No. All right. Well, let's head off here because Glenn has to go.
How about the closing music from Buckaroo Banzai? That's good. Yep.
No.
Anyway.
Give us a call. We gotta go. Everyone, blah, 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 save or die, something or other. Have a good night.
Good night, everybody!
Wow.
Good night, Gracie.
If you have any comments, please email saveordiepodcast@gmail.com or visit saveordie at saveordie.info. Follow the cast on Facebook/saveordiepodcast or follow them on Twitter @TheEvilDM.